Well, I'm really glad and humbled to be with you, and we have a deep love for Pastor Tony and Lindsay, and I know you do, and I know that you're blessed to be able to experience the same, the Word and His life among you, so we're just blessed to be around them and be with you today. I've been thinking lately, I invite you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, where I've been in some of my personal study. And as I've been thinking about 1 Corinthians 12, one of the things that came up is something that's interested me for a very long time. It's kind of a fascination of mine, is the idea of fads or trends. I've always been kind of fascinated by kind of the science or the sociology, you know, of why do certain things become fads? Why do certain things not catch on? Have you ever wondered why certain things catch on? Why don't certain things catch on? How many people does it take for something to catch on? You know that kind of stuff? Like, and if it doesn't, you know, just that kind of stuff, fads and trends. What's cool? What's not? Who said so? Who decides that kind of stuff? So I did a little bit of a research, and just for fun, I was looking back over the past several decades, and there's a lot of fads and a lot of trends, you know, over the years. And I went back as far back as the 1950s, and I looked at some fads or some trends from, say, the 1950s up till today, kind of decade by decade. So I thought it would be kind of fun this morning to read off maybe just a few of the popular fads or trends from each decade. And I thought one might be fun too is if you have participated or if you were into that fad ever, you maybe will raise your hand. Now, I'm just going to warn you ahead of time, what's going to happen is you're going to date yourself by when you raise your hand, okay? And there's going to be some of these that some of you are going to go, oh yeah, I know completely what that is. And then there's going to be some of these where some of you go, I have no idea what that is. So that's going to kind of indicate how old you are, okay? So I'm going to start back in the 50s, and I'll move up today, okay? So raise your hand on these. Hula hoop, good. Leather jacket or leather sweater, no, okay, all right? Poodle skirt, saddle shoes, sideburns. That's kind of a couple. Okay, now we're in the 1960s. Beatles records. Okay, bell-bottom jeans, lava lamps, mood ring, the twist, and tie-dye shirts. All right, 1970s, 8-track player, disco. Platform shoes. Okay. How many of you had the original Pong video game? Remember that? Star Wars action figures. Anybody have those? Alright. 1980s. Big hair. You had big hair or feathered hair. Feathered hair or big hair, okay? Boombox. How many of you have boombox? Okay, Converse All-Stars, remember those? Rubik's Cube, anybody have a Rubik's Cube? Okay, Where's the Beef, remember that favorite commercial? Okay, 1990s, Beanie Babies, anybody collect Beanie Babies? Anybody follow boy bands? Anybody have a fanny pack? Okay. Anybody do the Macarena? Anybody have a Tickle Me Elmo? Okay, 2000s Crocs came in. Okay. High School Musical had a big following. iPod came out. Napoleon Dynamite. Okay. Paintball. Anybody shoot paintball? Okay. And online slime. Okay, 2010s Angry Birds. Anybody play Angry Birds? Okay. Anybody watch Duck Dynasty? Anybody do Grumpy Cat memes? Okay, so some people go, I don't have no idea what that is. Zumba. All right. Those are fun. in the church, we have fads or trends too in the church. If you've been around the church for several decades or many decades, you can look back over the decades in churches and see trends, right? Different things, fads. Just as a side note for fun, has anybody ever been in that? How many of you are Nazarene? How many of you are longtime Nazarene? Has anybody ever been in a Nazarene church with orange carpet? The red carpet, orange carpet, okay, so there's fads in the church. Well, the reason I bring that up this morning is because in the church of Corinth, one of the things that Paul addressed when he wrote this letter, there's a bunch of issues he was addressing when he wrote this letter to them, of issues going on in the church. One of the issues was that they had kind of developed a fad or a trend in the church. And one of those fads was that they looked at all the gifts of the Spirit, and they kind of took this one gift of the Spirit, the gift of tongues. It was one of the gifts of the Spirit that even Paul lists in chapter 12. If you look down to even verse 10, it's right there. He talks about gifts of different kinds of tongues and another interpretation of tongues. But what happened in the church of Corinth is that they took that one gift and they focused so much on that, they made it kind of a fad or a trend in the church. You know how a fad works? A fad or a trend kind of works like, you know, if you're cool, you do this. And anybody who doesn't do this, well, you're not that cool. Or you're not that in. Or you don't got it. And they made this one gift of the Spirit kind of the test of whether you have the Holy Spirit or not. You know, there's lots of gifts of the Spirit. Paul lists some of them here in Corinthians chapter 12. But they took that one and they said, the fad in our church is everybody who's cool, everybody who's in, everybody who's really got it, everybody who's really into the Spirit has this one gift. That, and it kind of was that kind of a thing, how, you know how fads work. It's kind of like, you kind of get swept into it. It's kind of like, you know, you feel dumb if you're not into it. And so there's maybe some social peer pressure kind of thing. And it was kind of taking hold in the church. So Paul addresses that issue in these three chapters, chapter 12, 13, and 14 of Corinthians. Paul takes time, three chapters, to address this issue, this fad of the gift of tongues, and to try to bring some real proper perspective on it. And I'm just looking at the first three verses this morning, if you have your Bible, where he gives just some fundamental principles about it that he'll use the rest of the discussion, some really important fundamentals that he uses the rest of the time. So I'd like to just read verses 1 through 3 this morning. It says this, "Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried about to these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit." There's kind of three principles here, like fundamentals, when he starts talking about this one thing. One of them is this. One thing he tries to identify, especially in verse 2, is that is trying to help them remember what they were like when they were Gentiles, how the pagans operate. And he kind of gives this description, especially in verse 2, about this is how the pagans operate, not how Christians operate. This is how you guys used to be. This is not how we are. This is what you were. This is not who we are in Christ. And if you can kind of notice with me in verse 2, he says, "You know that you were Gentiles." The word in Greek when he says "you know," there can be several words that can be translated the same way in English, like love. Love has several Greek words translated the same way in English. Same word, same thing for know. This word for know means you know this because you've seen it. In other words, what he's trying to say to them is, hey, remember this? We've been there and done that. The whole Gentile thing, we've been there and done that. But the Lord saved us out of that. We're not pagans anymore. But what he's trying to get them to see is to recognize and remember and kind of distinguish this is the way the pagan culture operates. This is the way the pagan culture operates. All of the verbs in verse 2, there's several verbs. You know that you were Gentiles, you were carried about to these dumb idols, however you were led. All of those are in a tense in Greek that means an ongoing kind of activity. So what he's trying to describe is, this is the lifestyle among the Gentiles. This is not just how they are occasionally. This is not just how they are on some random days. this is how Gentiles act all the time. This is just kind of Gentile culture, what I'm talking to you about. This is just kind of how they are. Furthermore, he makes some connection. In the Greek, there's some interesting wording that suggests that being led away is kind of inherent to being a Gentile. Again, what he's just trying to get at is, through using several different words and several different descriptions, Paul's just trying to paint this picture to say, hey, Corinthians, this is how Gentiles act, this is what you were, and it's the ongoing lifestyle of Gentiles. It's normal. When you're a Gentile, this is normal. Nobody looks at Gentiles and sees them acting that way and says, well, I'm really surprised. No, you look at Gentiles acting this way and say, well, of course, they're Gentiles. That's how they always are. That's just routine, regular, normal activity for them. One of the other factors about how Gentiles act is there's two verbs in verse 2 where he says, you were carried away and you were led. Those are both in the passive voice. Now, I don't know how many of you are grammar fans this morning. I'm kind of a grammar nerd, you know, I kind of like that kind of stuff. And remember in your grammar that there is active voice and passive voice. Remember that? Remember all this? Is anybody having post-traumatic stress right now? Remember, active voice means the subject of the sentence is doing the action. Like, for instance, the boy hit the ball. That's an active verb. The boy's the subject, he's doing the action. Passive means the subject of the sentence is receiving the action. So it'd be like the boy got hit by the ball. The boy's receiving the action. And these verbs, you were led away, or you were carried away and you were led, are in the passive. It means that you guys, the Gentiles, in the midst of this lifestyle of how you're acting, a lot of what they're doing is just kind of, they're not active, they're passive. They're not leading, they're following, right? And that's, we all understand that's kind of how trends work, isn't it? That's kind of a lot of times how fads work, right? Is there anybody here that would join with me this morning in saying, when I was young, or maybe when I was not so young, there's sometimes that I wasn't using my head very much, and I just kind of went along with things without thinking about it very much. Anybody else besides me this morning ever did anything? You say, why in the world did I do that? Why in the world did I follow those people? I was not very active. I was passive. I was not really leading. I was following. One of my favorite little cartoons is this. There's this cartoon of this herd of little pigs running off a cliff, you know? And by this time, the lead pigs of the herd are already dropping off the front edge of the cliff, you know? And there's a little conversation going on between two little pigs at the back of the herd, and one little pig saying to the other one, I have no idea where we're going. And the other little pig says, it must be good if all these people are going there, right? It's kind of how trends and fads work, and that's what Paul is describing about the Corinthians. There doesn't seem to be much thought. There doesn't seem to be much self-control. There doesn't seem to be any order. As a matter of fact, if you back up to chapter 11, when he's talking to them about the Lord's Supper in chapter 11, it certainly sounds like that. In verse 21, in eating, each one takes his own supper ahead of others. One's hungry, another's drunk. Paul says, what? It's kind of just this chaos. Everybody's just kind of following along, just kind of being carried away. And the suggestion is that in the church, that's kind of what the speaking in tongues had become. The speaking in tongues had become kind of this, it becomes such a fad, such a trend, such a thing, well, that's what we all do, that it was this, everybody doing it without any thought about it. Everybody doing it passively, almost everybody just being caught up in something. That's how fads work. And Paul is saying, he's trying to desperately kind of remind them, That's what the pagans do. That's what the pagans do. You were Gentiles. And by the way, one more thing about that, all the verbs also in verse 2 are in the past tense. You were Gentiles. You were carried about. You were led. That's what we are. That's what we were. But how many of you believe with me and with the Apostle Paul this morning that Christians are to be different than the world? We're to be different. I'd be something different about us. I'm not talking this morning about we try to be different. You know, that can get weird. It's always gotten weird when Christians try real hard to make themselves different. We try to make some cookie cutter mold that we all fit into as Christians, and we try to set up some kind of rules and legalism about how we're different. That always gets kind of weird. But Paul's saying, when you let Jesus be in control of your life, you're going to be different than the world. You're going to be different than what you used to be. My question this morning, and I think he answers, is how? How do we be different? And the answer seems to be that in the focus of verses 1 through 3, especially when you get to verse 3, and then he affirms it in verses 4 through 6. We won't get to that this time. There's this focus on God himself. There's this focus on the Trinity. Can you see in verse 3 how Paul identifies really all three members of the Trinity? No one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. All three members of the Trinity. And then in verses 4 through 6, the three members of the Trinity. There are diversities of gifts, same Spirit, diversities of ministries, same Lord, Jesus. And there are diversities of activities, but the same God who works all in all, the members of the Trinity. God, Paul's saying the answer to us being different is not us. The answer is God. That's how we're different. You don't be different by you trying to be different. Anybody ever try New Year's resolutions? Right? You don't be different by you trying to be different. You be different because he makes you different. And at the center of the bullseye of that focus is this amazing statement that resonates through the early church. Jesus is Lord. You see it in verse 3? It's like the center of the bullseye. You want to be different? You want to be different than what it used to be? You want to see God do a new thing in your life? Get into this. Jesus is Lord. The focus is going to be on Jesus is Lord in my life. That's how I'm different. Jesus is Lord. Now, obviously, that's not where the focus of the Corinthians was. They were focused on all kinds of things, and in this particular instance, they were focused on the gift of the tongues, right? They got all caught up in that, and without going into a lot of detail this morning, the culture of their church kind of became to be this, anybody who's anybody is into tongues, and it was kind of this arrogance, and it was kind of this, you know, hey, we're really superior because we speak tongues, and we're sorry for the rest of y'all that don't speak tongues. We're sorry that you don't really have the Holy Spirit, but I guess we'll let you come anyway. We can use your tithe money, you know. But in whatever the case, you know, we're just kind of this arrogance, just kind of this, hey, this is, we're so superior, we're so awesome, we're so cool. Aren't we amazing that we speak tongues? And that became such the big focus, which, by the way, is why Paul opens chapter 13 the way he does, right? Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels and have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And the deal is this. The reason he makes the statement he does in verse 3 is this. That in order to focus so greatly on something else, they had to downplay Jesus. That's always true in my life. Whenever I get focused on something else, I lose focus on him. It seems to operate kind of in that kind of relationship, doesn't it? When I lift up something else, when I make something else the big deal, when there's anything in my life that I make a big deal, Jesus gets lost. Jesus gets downplayed somehow. And we don't exactly know how this was happening. He makes this statement in verse 3. We don't understand it all the way, where he says, no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. Who was saying Jesus is accursed? Who was saying that? Was it people in the church? Was it people out in the community? Was it Christians when they were out among their pagan friends? Who was saying Jesus is accursed? We don't exactly know, but the point seems to be this. Jesus was being downplayed. Jesus was being lessened for this being able to lift up tongues and the focus on tongues. And the point of the whole thing seems to be this. Really, the core of the passage seems to be this principle. The true evidence of the Holy Spirit is not speaking in tongues. The true evidence of the Holy Spirit is Jesus is Lord. That's what he's into. Of course, tongues is one of the gifts, and you can read for yourself, you know, beginning down several verses from now. In verse 10, he actually mentions tongues, and throughout the chapter, he's mentioning certain things. Chapter 14, he mentions things, and he lists some of the spiritual gifts, and certainly tongues is one of those. But the emphasis of the Holy Spirit is not the tongues. The emphasis of the Holy Spirit is Jesus is Lord. So what the Holy Spirit is really into is Jesus. But Jesus himself told us that, didn't he? Back in John chapter 16, when Jesus is in that upper room scene with the disciples and he's kind of pouring his heart into them about the kingdom and about what it's all about, he said this back in John 16, didn't he? Jesus said, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak and he will tell you things to come. Now listen to this. This is what Jesus said, John 16, 14. He, the Holy Spirit, will glorify me, Jesus. For he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. What does Jesus himself say the function of the Holy Spirit is? To glorify him. What's the Holy Spirit really into? Glorifying Jesus. What's the Holy Spirit really into? Pointing to Jesus. What's the Holy Spirit really into? Lifting up Jesus. What's the Holy Spirit really into? Revealing and exposing Jesus. So the test of the work of the Holy Spirit is what? When we gather together as Christians and we say, why, the Holy Spirit was really at work today. How do we know? Because somebody spoke in tongues. Not. Well, how do we know the Holy Spirit was at work today? Because the worship was awesome. Not. How do we know that the Holy Spirit was really at work today? Because the preacher was so impressive. Not. See, the test of the Holy Spirit is not that we're impressed with the preacher. It's not that we're impressed with the music. It's not that we're impressed with the architecture or the temperature in the sanctuary or anything else. The test of the Holy Spirit is that we walk out of here saying, isn't Jesus awesome? That we're enamored with Jesus. We're not enamored with the worship. We're not enamored with the preaching. We're not enamored with any single thing. We are enamored with Jesus himself. That's the test, and that's what Paul is saying he's trying to bring the church back to. It is all about Jesus. Again, tongues isn't bad. Everybody with me on that? Tongues is not evil. Tongues is not bad. It is one of the legitimate gifts of the Spirit. You can, whatever theological persuasion, I know it can be misused. I know it can be abused, and that's why he gives guidelines for it in chapter 14. It needs to be used appropriately. But it's not evil, and it's not bad, and it's not to be thrown out. So don't get the idea that it's bad, but get the idea of this. Anything can become off focus when Jesus isn't focused. Anything can become my thing. Anything can become my deal. Anything can become a distraction in my life, including preaching, including ministry, including worship, including church, if Jesus isn't the sole focus of it. One of my favorite devotional writers is Oswald Chambers. Oswald Chambers is probably one of my two or three favorite authors in the whole history of Christianity. Oswald Chambers wrote this. He said, embarrassment always arises in the domain of ethics when we make Christianity adherence to principles instead of personal relationship to God. When we make Christianity adherence to principles instead of personal relationship to God. What do I adhere to in my life besides Jesus? What is my thing? What is my cause? What is my big deal in my life? What is it that I... Is there anything in my life that I get caught up in that ends up taking the focus and Jesus gets downplayed? Can I be honest with you this morning, church family? Do you know how easy that is for me in my life? You wouldn't think so. Right? I mean, I'm a mature Christian of 30 years now. 30 plus years. You wouldn't think it'd be so easy to get distracted, would you? And yet, can I be honest with you this morning and saying, I myself and my life, maybe you're not like this, and I praise God if that's true. But do you know how easy it is for me to get caught up in something when I have to be so careful in what I read and what I listen to and what I watch? Because I seem to be susceptible to, in my life, I can read something, whether it be a book or Facebook or something or a blog, and I can start to get all stirred up and say, and that can become my, I need to adhere to that. Yeah, that becomes my principle, that becomes my cause, that becomes my... You know what I mean? You ever felt that in your life? I can get caught up, right? I can listen to talk radio and, or I can watch something on TV, and that becomes my thing, and I can get so caught up, and pretty soon what I find is that Jesus is being downplayed in my life because something else is being lifted up. It becomes something else for me to adhere to. Now again, we're not into legalism here. Jesus isn't legalistic. God's not legalistic. We're not into a legalism. If you really want to be focused on Jesus, burn your television set and throw away all your books. That's not what it is. But do you agree with me this morning that as we sang so beautifully this morning, we want to be in love with Him and we want Him to be the focus of our lives? I want to be caught up. I'm getting older now. My beautiful daughter is going to graduate on May 6th from Trevecca. And Melissa, you graduate that day too? Awesome. So we're going to be, that's going to be a great event. Cody, we're pulling for you. One more year. And on that day, I'll turn 50 years old on that day. My daughter graduates from Trevecca. And the older I get, the more I keep coming back to this simple thing. Just Jesus. Just Jesus. Not a legalism, but adhering to Him and Him alone. I want to be about Him. I want to know Him. I want to preach Him. And I want my life to speak Him. And I want everything else to become lesser. And Him to become greater. How? There was a surprise answer for me in verse 3. I happen to notice in verse 3 that there are three different words that refer to speaking. I don't know if you can see them with me. There's three different words that refer to speaking. No one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus Christ, and no one can say, see those? No one speaking calls and say. What I happen to notice is that those three words are all different Greek words. And that can't be an accident. There's no way that a biblical writer inspired by the Holy Spirit uses three separate Greek words to communicate the idea of communication in the same verse without it meaning something. So I started to look at them in a new way. And what I was really struck with was that third one when it says, no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. No one can say. I've heard that phrase many, many times in my Christian life. Listened to it. Probably not understood it all the way. No one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. What I learned was that Greek word, I've seen this Greek word many, many times. It's a very common word in the New Testament. It's always one of those ones that you just kind of see it and just kind of love. It just means to say something, right? It's the Greek word apon. Apon. And it's used there when it says no one can say Jesus is Lord. And I learned something, I decided to look into it a little more deeply. And what I learned about apon is that it's not just simply to say something. It literally means to speak something to someone. Fascinating. To speak something, not just to say something in direct address to somebody. That's why it's used hundreds of times throughout the Gospels when it says things like, Jesus answered and said to them. It's not just that Jesus is speaking something in the air. He's literally addressing something to somebody. So this time, I wonder if Cody could come and play your guitar for us, and Lindsay's going to, we're going to get ready for our closing song, but I want to talk to you about this, because this really solved the mystery to me about that statement. Now, do you see the statement? No one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. This really solved the mystery for me because I have struggled with that statement many, many times. Because here's what I thought in my mind. It says, nobody can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. And I thought to myself, well, anybody can utter those words. You know what I mean? I could write the words, Jesus is Lord, on a 3x5 card. I could walk out on Old Hickory Boulevard, and I could hand it to any person I see on Old Hickory today on the way home from church and say, read this, I'll give you $1. Okay, Jesus is Lord. What does that mean, they have the Holy Spirit? I don't think so. It doesn't mean that. You can't, Jesus is Lord. Oh, that person has the Holy Spirit. No. what this word apon means. It's direct address. No one can say to him. Jesus is Lord. In other words, Jesus, you're my Lord. You're Lord. You're Lord over me. You're my Lord. Now that's what the Holy Spirit is about. That's the work of the Holy Spirit. To move me into that relationship and in my life bring everything under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And what I realized this morning is this, church family. What if I just kept doing that in my life? What if my life consisted of all day long, every day, walking around in constant awareness and saying, Jesus, you're Lord. Jesus, you're Lord of everything. You're Lord of my life. You're Lord of my future. You're Lord of my health. And you're Lord of my family. You're Lord of my kids. And you're Lord of my marriage. And you're Lord over my work. And you're Lord over this church. And you're Lord over whatever. And you're Lord. And what if I just walked around all day constantly saying, Jesus is Lord? You know what? It'd be awful hard to get off focus, wouldn't it? As a matter of fact, you can't do both. I couldn't be off focus and say, Jesus, you're Lord at the same time. So what if I just started bringing him into every single area of my life and saying, Jesus, you're Lord of that. And if there's a situation that's going on, and I just, okay, Jesus, I'm going to get you in the middle of this and say, you're Lord of this, see what he does with it. I got a problem. Okay, Jesus, you're Lord. What do you want to do? So if you had to fill in the blank this morning, what would it be? Jesus, you are Lord of. What do you need to say that over this morning? What is it in your life that you yourself need to bring to the Lord Jesus this morning and say, Jesus, you are Lord of. Let me see if I can explain this. Do you have any activities in your life that, you know how when you do repetitive activity in your life, you tend to, like, your mind wanders? Do you have anything like that in your life? Like, it's like some activity that you just, it's like routine and habit, and so it's that chore or whatever you do, and so while you're doing it, I had one lady a couple weeks tell me that, for me, it's ironing. And whenever I iron, my mind, and your mind gets bombarded by thoughts because you're kind of passive almost. You're doing it, whatever, and you can get, your mind just thinking about stuff and wandering and bombarded by thoughts. You know what I mean? For me, I have two things in my life. One of them is weed eating. Okay? When I'm weed eating, you're out there for an hour, whatever, your mind just gets bombarded by thoughts. And the other time is, this is really weird, but shaving in the morning. I've done it like 1,000 times in my life, right? So you're shaving, and when you're shaving, you get bombarded by all these thoughts, all these problems, all these things, all these worries, all these concerns, and you find pretty soon, what you realize is 10 minutes later, I just spent the last 10 minutes consumed in my little world with all these things. Well, what happened is in the middle of that, I just started saying, okay, while I'm shaving, Jesus, you're Lord of that. And you're Lord of that. And oh, you're Lord of that too. And you're Lord. And you're Lord. And you know what, everybody? This morning, that's not a fad. That's the Christian. That's what he wants to do.